We are live now.
Good morning to everybody and welcome to this session on immobilization and aging. I am Maria Francesca Piacentini and I am from the University of Rome Foro Italico, and I will be chairing this session together with my co-chairs Paul Greenup and Jose Gonzalez Alonso from the UK. I first of all would like to thank ECSS for the great effort in putting this virtual conference together, and specifically for all the people who are working around the clock to make possible also all these live sessions. I remember that this is a YIA session, so it's a Young Investigator Award. And to all the speakers, I recall that you have 10 minutes of presentation, and the last minute of the presentation, I will be giving you a warning if you're not towards the end. And thereafter, you will be having 5 minutes of questions for you. So I will be presenting the first speaker, who is Julian Alcazar from the University of Castilla-La Mancha. And he will be presenting on the circulating GDF 15 as an independent predictor of mechanical sit-to-stand power in healthy men and women aged 20 to 93 years old. Please.
Thank you for the introduction. I'll be talking about the relationship between GDF-15 and sit-to-stand power, and also with AIDS in healthy men and women aged between 20 and 93 years old. I cannot move the slide. No. Okay, relative mass of power, which is the ratio between allometric power and body mass index, has been more strongly associated with mobility limitations, frailty, disability, and poor quality of life than sarcopenia. In addition, we recently reported that relative mass of power start to decline after the age of 40 years in both women and men. And these declines are due, firstly, to a loss of allometric power and an increase in BMI, and later in life, only due to a decline in allometric power. Therefore, allometric power is an interesting measure to take into account. On the other hand, growth differentiation factor 15 is a cytokine that is released under conditions of cellular stress or injury. And proteomic studies, including more than 1,000 plasma proteins, found that GDF-15 is one of the strongest predictors of the incidence in mobility limitations in older people. In addition, circulating GDF-15 has been reported to increase with age in a curvilinear fashion, but the specific age point about which there is a significant increase in GDF-15 has not been reported previously. Therefore, the main goals of the present investigation were to evaluate the relationship between circulating GDF-15 and age, and to evaluate the relationship between circulating GDF-15 and muscle power. Participants from the Copenhagen sarcopenia study were included in this investigation, so a total of 1,151 well-functioning people aged between 20 and 93 years old were included. Body composition was assessed with dual energy array axiometry, and FAC index and skeletal muscle index were calculated. In addition, muscle power was assessed with the Nottingham Power Rig, which is a device that assesses leg extension power during an explosive and unilateral action. But in addition, we also assessed functional muscle power during the sit-to-stand test using a previously validated equation that considered the individual's anthropometric information and sit-to-stand performance. Given that the association with physical performance has been reported to be higher with the sit-to-stand power test when compared to the Nottingham power rig, we preferentially used sit-to-stand power during this presentation. GDF15 was assessed from plasma samples, while several inflammation markers such as plasma TNF-alpha and serum high sensitivity CRP were also assessed. To assess the relationship between GDF15 and age, we use mainly segmented regression analysis, while to assess the relationship between GDF15 and muscle power, we use linear mixed effect models. Here we have the main results of this investigation regarding the association between GDF15 and age. We observe a clear curvilinear relationship with GDF15 increasing with age in both women and men. Of note, there were not significant differences between young men and young women, or between middle-aged women and middle-aged men. But the levels of GDF15 were significantly higher in older men when compared to older women. Regarding the results given by the segmented regression analysis, we observed that there was an acceleration in the increase in GDF15 after the age of 65 years in women and 70 years in men. And importantly, there were significant differences in these slopes, and men showed higher increases in GDF15 compared to women. Regarding the association between GDF15 and muscle power, we observe a significant and negative relationship between both measures. So per each 100 decrease in GDF15, there was a 10 watt decline in muscle power, in this case in women. This relationship remained statistically significant after adjusting for age. After adjusting for age and fat index, and after adjusting for age, fat index, and inflammatory markers. Similar results were reported in men, where we saw a significant and negative relationship between plasma GDF15 and allometric sit-to-stand power that remained statistically significant after adjusting for age and either fat index, skeletal muscle index, or BMI, and after adjusting for age, fat index, and the inflammatory markers. On the contrary, although we observed a significant and inverse relationship between plasma GDF15 and leg extension power obtained in the Nottingham power rig, this relationship disappeared after adjusting for age, fat index, and the inflammatory markers. It has been reported that GDF15 participates in several actions such as apoptosis and in the antipertrophic anti-inflammatory responses, but it is also true that the effect of GDF15 can be highly specific to the state of the cell and its environment. In this sense, in humans, it has been reported that higher levels of GDF15 and mRNA led to reductions in several microRNAs involved in muscle proliferation, differentiation, and recovery. In addition, higher levels of plasma GDF15 have been correlated with reductions in muscle cross-sectional area and also with muscle weakness. On the other hand, in mice, it has been reported that the AKT-independent activation of mTORC1, which seems to increase during human aging, is related to an increase in the expression of GDF15 in muscle, leading to muscle atrophy, muscle weakness, and the loss of type 2 fiber, which could be, the latter finding could be highly related with the association between muscle power and GDF15 independently of muscle mass. On the contrary, GDF15 deficient mice has been reported to develop motor neuron loss in the spinal cord and also have shown decreased physical performance. Indeed, it is known that Schwann cells in the motor neurons are able to release GDF15 and that this GDF15 can be transported to axon. So therefore, GDF15 is also considered a trophic factor for motor and sensory neurons. In conclusions, we observed that plasma GDF15 levels increase significantly with age in both women and men, that these increases were accelerated after the age of 65 years among women and 70 years among men, and the age-related increase in plasma GDF15 was greater in men compared to women. And finally, plasma GDF15 levels were negatively associated with allometric cytostatin power in both women and men, independently of age, adiposity, and inflammatory markers. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Julian, for your very interesting and clear presentation. And I'm leaving the possibility to ask questions from my co-chairs. So if Paul and Jose have questions.
Yeah, maybe I can start. From my knowledge of the literature is I'm aware of an association of GDF15 with obesity and inflammation. So the question I have, two really, the first one is, have you looked at the relationship between GDF15 in the plasma and obesity and inflammatory markers in these individuals?
Yeah, it is a good question. In the first case, there is no relationship. If you take the whole sample, there is no relationship between GDF15 and BMI, for example, or fat index. But if you only take all the people, then you can see a small but significant relationship about an R value of, if I remember well, 0.10. So it's very small compared with the relationship with muscle power. But there is a relationship, and for that reason, we adjusted in the following models, we adjusted for BMI. And there is also a relationship with the inflammatory markers. Of course, for that reason, we wanted to see if the relationship between GDF15 and muscle power was independent of the relationship of the inflammatory markers with muscle power.
Okay. So one thing you might want to do going forward is given you see some associations in the old between GDF15 and obesity and inflammation, it might be useful to do analysis of covariance so you can actually see the contribution of all of the factors that are known rather than just power. My other question, if I may ask one, is, you found no association with power output when you quantified it using the Nottingham Power Rig, which is known to be a widely used piece of apparatus that is very good at assessing power across age. So how do you explain the lack of a relationship with a more sensitive and accurate measure of power?
Yeah. We first need to analyze the differences between the cytostatin power test and the Nottingham Power Rig test. The cytostatin power test takes like 30 seconds, so we are actually measuring average muscle power during 30 seconds, while in the Nottingham Power Rig, we are assessing muscle power in an explosive effort lasting less than 1 second. In this context, GDF15 has also been reported as a biomarker of mitochondrial dysfunction. So maybe it has something to do with the duration of the effort, given that maybe the participants with higher levels of GDF15 are also the participants with mitochondrial dysfunction, at least in some degree. So that might be one reason. And the other reason might be that it has been also found that there might be a relationship between the GDF15 levels and the central nervous system. And in this sense, of course, the sit-to-stand task needs of a higher motor control when compared to the Nottingham Power Rig, where the subjects are in the sitting position and they just have to move one leg in an explosive movement, while in the sit-to-stand task, you need balance, coordination, and it is an action of two legs. So maybe the motor control is also higher during the sit-to-stand test, and perhaps that has something to do with the effect of GDF15 on the central nervous system as well.
Thank you.
Very good presentation, Julian. I have a question regarding to your differences, the greater GDF15 in men older than 65 versus women. I just wondered, there was a lot of a scatter in the data and that age range in the highest one. And I just wonder whether those differences that you have established are more statistical due to the model that you use than real actually differences due to sex. Can you
What we saw was that there are no differences between men and women at young age and also in middle age, and it has been also reported in other study that there are no sex differences regarding GDF15, but there is one study conducted in older people that they also see significant differences between men and women at older age. So this is similar compared with our results. And I think that what we add is that the differences at older age are due to men exhibiting a higher increase in GDF15 during aging. So I do think that there are differences between older men and older women, confirmed also in other study with a large cohort of older people. And I think that we add that this difference at older age is because the slopes of the increase in GDF15 during aging from young to older people is higher in men compared to women.
Okay,
we need to move on. Sorry.
Thank you.
So let's try to keep the schedule. So thank you very much, Julian. And we will be moving to the next presenter. That's Jasmine Dumortier from University of Ghent. And she will be presenting Sleeping Towards Medals, the difference in qualitative sleep between elite and non-elite gymnasts.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. I will present my study on the qualitative sleep measurements of elite and non-elite gymnasts. So, sleep is of most importance for the recovery, especially in athletes. And sleep is divided into two phases. First is non-REM sleep, which is non-rapid eye movement sleep occurs. This goes from stage 1 and 2 until stage 3 with an increasing arousal threshold. This last stage, which is also known as slow wave sleep, is also important for the physical recovery. This is due to growth hormones, among other reasons. Secondly, you have the rapid eye movement sleep, also known as dream sleep. And during this phase, especially mental recovery is important. So we all know to what proportion these spaces are divided in Athens, and certainly not in elite Athens. Therefore, we have focused on one elite group, as in this study is elite gymnastics. We chose for this group because they have a really high amount of training volume and training intensity. But since elite athletes, and especially elite gymnasts, already have to train a lot from a young age on, they have to combine this high training schedules with school timetables, so their recovery time is limited. Also, in competition athletes, elite athletes, and especially females, are prone to stress-related sleep problems. So we can suggest that they have a higher need for recovery, and we want to see if there are structural adaptations in their sleep, which distinguishes elite athletes from non-elite athletes. Therefore, we want to compare two groups of elite and non-elite gymnasts in sleep characteristics. So we had 12 elite gymnasts and 10 control gymnasts from a non-elite level. The last two couldn't be tested due to the COVID-19 pandemic, but they all did the same protocol. So first, after a day where they did not train, they did an incremental treadmill test to evaluate their physical fitness. And secondly, a day following a normal training day, they did an overnight stay in the sleep laboratory with polysomnography, which assesses in a gold standard their sleep. During this polysomnography, they were equipped with several measurement systems, among others also electroencephalography, electrocardiography, and electromyography. Also, their posture during sleep was detected and evaluated. Their breathing was evaluated using thorax and abdomen sensors, and oxygen saturation was monitored throughout the day. With all these measurements, 30 seconds epochs of every night, of this night, sorry, were evaluated in such a way that correct representation of the sleep could be monitored. And now I can move on from my slide. Okay. If we look into the subject, I already told we had 12 elite gymnasts and non-elite gymnasts. So the elite gymnasts were all junior and senior finalists at European and World Championships, and also younger internationally competing gymnasts of a high performance school. Non-elite gymnasts were only competing regionally. So we see, I will try again to point it out. We have matched them for their age. Height and body weight did not differ among the groups, as was the body mass index. But as expected, the oxygen uptake and the training volume were higher compared to the gymnast group. So we see at the amount of hours that it's actually related. If we look into the results, we see that time in bed and total sleep time did not differ between the groups, and the sleep efficiency, which is the percentage of proportion of time in bed spent asleep, did not differ between the groups. So 85% is in fact the limit for a good sleep, so we see that both groups are well beyond that. Also, sleep wanted latency, which is the time needed to fall asleep, did not differ, as was the wake duration after sleep onset. Micro awakenings were higher in the non-elite gymnasts. So these micro awakenings are, in fact, awakenings that last up to 15 seconds. And these are not consciously experienced, but they can elicit a higher or a feeling of less fitness in this group. So micro awakenings did not differ, but since the awakening index is the summing of both these factors, the more micro awakenings caused a higher awakening index, which is higher than the upper limit, which is suggested for a good sleep of, and is 20 to 22 per hour. Lastly, we have the apnea-hypopnea index, which was not different between the groups, and scores on the Epworth Sleepiness Scale, which is a scale which assesses daytime sleepiness, was also in the normal range and it improved. If we look at sleep proportion, and this is what was of most interesting, we see that the elite gymnast has have a higher percentage of slow wave sleep compared to the non-elite gymnast. As their sleep quantity was equal during the night, this might suggest that the elite gymnast have a higher recuperative deep sleep compared to the non-elite gymnasts. This suggests that because there is a higher amount of slow wave sleep. Also, growth hormone is more released, which helps in the restitution of the tissue fibers and muscle. The 24% we see in the non-elite gymnast is in fact equal to the slow wave sleep seen in a sample of a study of Scholl et al., who studied this in non-elite athletic and a non-athletic group at all. So in persons who did not do physical activity or sport. So we can think that the acute training load did not cause the differences. So to compensate for the larger amount of slow wave sleep, non-REM sleep stage 2 was diminished compared to the non-elite gymnast. The meaning of that is not that clear. The other phases were equal among the groups. So we can conclude, and this is very important because it's the first study to assess actual sleep proportion in elite gymnast versus non-elite gymnast. We can conclude that the slow wave sleep is in fact higher in the elite gymnast. This may be due because they need the recovery for the high training volume and intensity, and because they have a higher fitness level, and also it is possible that elite gymnasts have a genetic advantage so they can cope with these rigorous training schedules. It is, however, most likely that a combination of these factors cause the higher slow wave sleep, and that this is necessary to reach and especially to maintain elite gymnastics. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your interesting and very, very clear presentation. Before leaving the floor, I just have a question regarding, so if I understood correctly, it's an acute study, like one night only for elite and non-elite gymnasts in the lab. And what phase of their training were there? I mean, would it be different close to competition compared? I don't know if this was an off-season.
Well, it was during the general training phase. So it was not during a competition phase. It was during the general training phase in the beginning of the season. Not the first weeks, but after the first mesocycle. So the general preparation phase, you can say.
Okay, so but you have no real training load measurements in terms of.
You only have the hours of training they did that day.
Okay. Jose and Paul, do you have questions?
I had the same question as you, Maria, because I think the only way to elucidate whether it is there's a genetic component or not is to establish what will happen over a season when those elite gymnasts are in peak shape versus when they are off season. So I know that that seems that this hasn't been done, but what would you predict that would be the case if you did that study off-season versus competitive period of the season?
I think that since I have looked into two samples and I looked into the inter-individual variations also, that there would still be a difference between the groups, but maybe slow wave sleep would be a bit less extreme high than it was now. So it might be a bit lower, but I think it would still be different and higher than the non-elite gymnast. they were in practically the same training period.
So you are implying that they are staying a genetic component?
Yes, or because of the long-term loading from young age on, they have been more training hours, more training load, that this has caused the increased slow wave sleep, which is chronic. Maybe not entirely genetic, but it, because of it's chronic, and then because of the chronic training load, it's elevated, the slow wave sleep is elevated.
How many minutes are you accounting for the difference in slow wave sleep between the two groups? Is that like 10 minutes or so? The difference between 37% and 25% that you find, what if you translate that in minutes?
In minutes, I don't have my papers here, but if you look into the difference of 13% of a night's sleep of 8 hours and a half, then you are already, I think it's 30 minutes, 40 minutes. I don't know exactly, but it's quite extensive if you look at that.
Okay. Paul, go ahead if you have a question.
It surprised me when I calculated the sleep time. So they're both sleeping for about 7.2 hours, which to me seems short. So that this led me to think, how do you familiarize someone for these types of experiments? Were they brought into a sleep laboratory? Did they have to, did you measure their habitual sleep time, for example? It just seems 7 hours is, or 7.2 hours is relatively short. And you yourself just said a typical night's sleep of 8.5 hours.
Yeah, so we asked them after the night if they slept worse or the same or better than usual. And it was a bit mixed. I think two or three of the group said I slept worse. Most of them slept the same. So in that case, there were no large difference between their normal sleep and sleep in the sleep laboratory. But however, since the time of the night of the recording of the night was limited, they could choose whether they went to bed earlier, but it was always recorded the whole night. For them, it was sufficient in that night to sleep that amount of time. But it was not a fact really different in other nineties.
Okay, I have to
know.
Say,
Sorry.
Well, time goes by. So thank you, Jasmine. And we will go to the next speaker, that is Elena Monti from the University of Padova. And she has a presentation on early biomarkers of muscle atrophy and of neuromuscular alterations during 10-day bed rest. Please.
Good morning. Can you see my screen? Okay. So thank you for the introduction. My talk today will concern the early neuromuscular adaptations to 10 days of bed rest. So unloading is known to induce muscle and single fibers atrophy as well as functional impairment, and it does so in a very short time. Thus, the first aim of this study was that to investigate the possible reasons behind the disease-induced muscle atrophy, and we wonder whether this reason would be only reconducible to the well-accepted lack of mechanical loading and reduction in muscular activity, or whether there could be other contributors, such as neuromuscular junction damage or denervation processes, as recently suggested. In addition, if we look at the amount of muscle force and mass loss, we can definitely see that the contractile impairment is much more marked than the loss of muscle size. So, as a second aim of this study, we wonder which could be the early contributors to such imbalance, in the early stages of muscle unloading. Some of these contributors, such as muscular architecture and tendon properties adaptations, have been widely investigated and shown to contribute to this phenomenon only partially, while others, such as neuromuscular junction damage and the alteration in the innervation pattern, once again, have received much less attention. In addition, at the single fiber level, alterations in the calcium dynamics have been shown, have been reported after mid-term bed rest. But in any studies, these alterations have been shown to begin much earlier. And therefore, we wondered whether the alteration in calcium dynamics handlings could be another possible factor that would contribute to the imbalance and the greater decrease in muscle force if compared to muscle size. We therefore set up a 10-day bed rest, and we hypothesized that at the end of this period, we would observe muscle and single fibers atrophy, accompanied by an even more marked functional decline and an increased instability of the neuromuscular junction together with the alterations of the innervation pattern. And that these last, together with sarcoplasmic reticulum impairment of calcium handling, would be early contributors of the more marked loss of muscle force if compared to its mass. We recruited 10 healthy males who spent 10 days in the hospital of Izola in Slovenia. And we chose three time points for our analysis, which were BR0, that is the baseline, and the follow-up, BR10, together with a midpoint, that is BR5. At BR0 and BR10, we collected the MRIs to measure muscle volume and ultrasound images of the vastus lateralis and the quadriceps muscle to measure the cross-sectional area. We also performed functional tests in order to obtain the maximum voluntary contraction, activation capacity, and rate of force development in vivo. And we collected a blood sample and a biopsy from the mid vastus lateralis. At BR5, we only collected ultrasound images, once again, of the vastus lateralis and the quadriceps, a blood sample, and a biopsy. Coming to the results, concerning muscle volume, we measured both the vastus lateralis and the quadriceps cross-sectional area in different axials in order to obtain and calculate the volume. And as you can see, for both the muscles, we observed a significant decrement after 10 days of bed rest. And when we measured cross-sectional area, once again, of the vastus lateralis and the whole quadriceps, with ultrasound in order to obtain a midpoint at BR5, we observed, of course, the same decrease in muscle mass for both the vastus lateralis and the quadriceps, which was more marked between day 5 and day 10 in both cases. From a functional point of view, we measured the maximum force our subject could exert by requiring a maximum voluntary contraction. And as you can see, force is reduced by about 14%, and this was accompanied by a decreased explosiveness of the movement, here measured as the time to reach the 63% of the maximum force. In addition, we used the interpolated twitch technique, which consists in giving two superimposed twitch during maximum voluntary contraction performance and one potentiated twitch at rest. And by using the equation that you can see displayed, we also measure the activation capacity. That is the capacity of the central nervous system to recruit the motor units during a maximal effort performance. And as you can observe, this parameter was not altered, at least after only 10 days of bed rest. Now it's clear that seeing the amount of force lost, which is about three times that of muscle volume, we also observed, as previously reported, a decrement in muscle-specific force, which is its force normalized for its cross-sectional area. And it was significantly reduced by about 10%. All these morphofunctional changes were accompanied by neurodegeneration, which we measured by dosing the C-terminal fragment of a protein called agrin, which it constitutes the end plate of the neuromuscular junction, and it's cleaved upon neurotrypsin action. And this C-terminal fragment is released upon cleavage of agrin. The cleavage of this protein is known to induce degeneration of the neuromuscular junction, and therefore increased levels of circulating agrin in serum reflect an increased neuromuscular junction instability. And what we could see was that within the 10 days of bed rest, we had a progressively increased amount of this fragment within the serum, which was significantly higher at BR10 by 19%. These changes were matched with an increased amount and percentage of fibers positive for the neural cell adhesion molecule staining. NCAM is considered a marker of reinnervation and denervation and is re-expressed and relocalized on the sarcoplasm and the sarcolemma by fibers that suffer and start to be denervated. And as you can see, these parameters, this parameter increased linearly through the 10 days of bed rest, but was significantly different from BR0 only after 10 days. Having seen the kinetics of the morphological changes and the neurodegeneration marker changes, we cannot draw a definitive conclusion about whether neurodegeneration would precede muscular atrophy, because all these markers became significantly different from baseline only after 10 days. But we can for sure insert neurodegeneration between the elements, the factors that would contribute to the imbalance between muscle force loss and muscle size loss. Further investigating in this direction, we also measure our single fibers properties. And firstly, we measured the single fibers diameters in order to estimate their cross-sectional area, and we confirmed a very strong trend for a selective atrophy of fast fibers. We then activated our fibers and recorded the maximum force they could exert. And by normalizing force over their cross-sectional area, we could obtain the maximum tension of fibers, which you can see is not different between BR0 and BR10. However, during these mechanical experiments, we put fibers in high calcium concentration solutions, and calcium can flow inside the fiber from their permeabilized membrane. But in physiological conditions, calcium does not flow inside the fiber from the external environment, but it's stored within the sarcoplasmic reticulum and released in the sarcoplasm upon action potential arrival. And therefore, in order to simulate in a more close way what would happen in a contraction in vivo, we performed some experiments with caffeine, which is known to induce the release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum of fibers. As you can see from the graph, both low and fast fibers presented much lower responses to caffeine exposure after the 10 days of bed rest if compared to the baseline. Now, this wave that we can measure in response to caffeine is the result of two different elements. One is the concentration of calcium released upon caffeine exposure, and the other is the myofibrillar sensitivity to calcium, which if summed, would give us the wave that we can measure. In order to understand in which situation we were and to eliminate the second hypothesis, we exposed our fibers to different known concentration of calcium. Yeah, and we measured the so-called force PCA curves. We obtained in order to obtain the concentration of calcium necessary to elicit the 10 and the 50% of the maximum force. And as you can see, no differences were detectable, ruling out the possibility of myofibrillar sensitivity to calcium impairments. Therefore, we concluded that we are in a situation where the sarcoplasmic reticulum calcium handling is impaired, which is also supported by a decreased SARCA2 level measured by Western blot. We concluded that unloading through the lack of mechanical loading and a reduction in physical activity may induce wall muscle and single fibers atrophy, together with other changes, degenerative changes at the single fiber level. But in addition, would also lead to neuromuscular junction instability and initial fiber denervation, which would mutually contribute to fibers atrophy, and possibly also elicit sarcoplasmic calcium handling impairment. All these elements together would contribute to the impairment in wall muscle and single fiber contractility. I would finally like to thank all my research group and all the people who performed the experiments with us.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I'll ask my colleagues if they have some questions.
Maybe I can start. So very nicely presented, a lot of data. first, a simple question. Why did you choose 10 days when, you know, you're referencing studies that have used 3 days and shown, for example, NCAM positive fibers? And then the second question is, what do you think the most novel finding of this study is compared to the published literature?
Okay, so we chose 10 days because we were aware about a study performing a dry immersion lasting for 3 days and showing the increased percentage of NCAM positive fibers. But dry immersion is known to be a very extreme model of unloading. It eliminates completely the gravity effects. And we wanted to better simulate the clinical settings where a person would be exposed to when, for example, undergoing an surgery or an immobilization due to illness, for example. And so in order to be sure to see some changes in a, let's say, less severe model, we decided to perform an experiment of 10 days. And that's why we also chose to take a midpoint of 5 days as an early point for our measurements. And I believe the novelty of this finding could be found both in the timing, because this is the first, let's say, report for now, as far as I know, of course, that shows that this adaptation in some clinical, in settings very similar to those experienced by a clinical population may occur. And yes, and also we try to dose also some biomarkers such as CAF, which can be taken out by the blood samples and do not require an invasive technique such as a biopsy to be measured, and which could be a possible biomarker to be used in clinics, for example. And yes, I believe that by putting some pieces together with these very early impairments in calcium dynamics, which haven't been reported so far, we may contribute to explain why we lose so much strength, which is a very important problem for, I think, about an elderly person who stays in the bed, for example.
Okay, one quick question, if I can. So obviously the sarcoplasmic reticulum is external to the myofiber. It's not an intracellular component. So in your isolation of fibers, do you know the effect of this on the sarcoplasmic reticulum? Do you know, how do you test its viability?
From as far as I know, these experiments with isolation of fibers do not touch in any way the sarcoplasmic reticulum structure. We didn't perform any assessment because it was quite clear from the literature. So we didn't perform any additional analysis.
Thank you.
I have a general question. I was, I know I don't work in this area, but I was very impressed by the data and the presentation. I have a general question in regard, just a prediction of what will you think that will happen is in one of the legs, you will do small contractions every day, maybe for an hour. Do you think that you will be able to prevent all these changes and decreases in power and also the structural changes you have seen?
So from what we didn't perform any of these tests, but I've been reading the literature, and there are some experiments trying to use isometric contractions in order to slow down the insurgence of atrophy and functional decline. However, for now, it hasn't been proven that this is effective in completely prevent. It may slow down, but it doesn't prevent the loss of muscle force and muscle mass that we observed with this use. It for sure can be a strategy, but for now, it hasn't been proven to be winning at all.
Okay. Thank you. This is, that's probably will allow you to investigate what are the systemic versus more local effects, right? If you have one effect that is the condition versus the other, that is strain. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Elena. And we will go to the next speaker and last speaker of this session. Cas Fuchs from Maastricht University, who will be presenting daily blood flow restriction does not attenuate muscle mass and strength loss during 2 weeks of bed rest. Please.
Yeah, so thank you very much for the introduction. And I would also like to thank ECSS for the opportunity to present here today. So when we get ill or when we are injured, we're often subjected to prolonged periods of bed rest. And when this happens, and if we would look specifically at a muscle level, then we can see clear reductions in muscle protein synthesis rates, clear reductions in muscle mass, and also clear reductions in muscle strength. Now, just to give you a specific example, so in our lab previously, a study was performed where it was assessed what the effects are of 1 week of bed rest. And in that study, it was observed that after a single week of bed rest, there was a loss of 1.4 kilograms in lean body mass. And when focusing more specifically on the quadriceps muscle, it was observed that the reduction of quadriceps cross-sectional area was more than 3%. Now, this is very problematic because we know that especially when we get older, that we may not fully recover from these periods of bed rest. And thereby, this substantially contributes to the decline in the lean muscle mass and also muscle strength that we typically see over the lifespan. And this also contributes to developing certain metabolic diseases. It increases the risk of falling, and it also increases the risk of mortality. So clearly, it is important to find strategies to see whether we can attenuate the loss in muscle mass and also strength during such a period of bed rest. Now, one potential strategy could be blood flow restriction. And so blood flow restriction, what you basically do is you place a cuff around one of the limbs. You inflate the cuff until a certain pressure is achieved. You hold it for a couple of minutes and then you deflate the cuff again. Now, probably many of you will know blood flow restriction because it's a very popular strategy nowadays in more an exercise setting. But it has also been suggested that when blood flow restriction applied passively could be beneficial, especially, for example, during a period of disuse. And so the first study that investigated this, what they did, they had patients recovering from ACL reconstruction. They put them into a knee brace for 2 weeks afterwards. And then what they basically did is they had one group, they got daily blood flow restriction, whereas the other group did not. And when they looked into the decrease in quadriceps cross-sectional area, they saw that this was substantially lower in the group that was restricted when compared to the control group. Now, this would suggest that blood flow restriction on its own could be some kind of an exercise mimetic that has specific anabolic effects. However, based on this study and also some subsequent studies that have shown similar findings, it remained unknown what these anabolic effects could be. Now, more recently, a study was performed in rats, and in that study, what they found was that when blood flow restriction was applied passively to one leg, that they found an increase in the phosphorylation of anabolic signaling markers, so such as P70S6 kinase and also RPS6. Now, this could suggest that if you apply blood flow restriction, that you can increase muscle protein synthesis rates and thereby attenuate the loss in muscle mass as well as strength. However, this has never been assessed in a bed rest model. So the effects of blood flow restriction during bed rest on muscle protein synthesis, muscle mass, and muscle strength have never been assessed. Now, we wanted to investigate this, and we hypothesized that blood flow restriction during 14 days of bed rest would attenuate the reduction in muscle protein synthesis rate and thereby attenuate the loss in muscle mass and also strength. Now, in order to investigate this, we recruited 12 healthy young male individuals. They were all subjected to 14 days of complete bed rest, so they were not allowed to leave the bed for any reason. And we ensured that the diet was completely provided and standardized by us. Now, the blood flow restriction was on a single leg. So we did 3 sessions every day, in the morning, the afternoon, as well as the evening. And during each of those sessions, we applied 3 times a restriction of 5 minutes at 200 millimeter mercury pressure. So in total, during the day then, one leg on every day was restricted for a total of 9 times of 5 minutes. Now, the other leg served as the sham control condition, and so we did place a cuff around the leg, but we only inflated to a pressure of 10 millimeter mercury, of which we know it has no effect on blood flow. Now, we assessed muscle strength before as well as after bed rest for both legs separately. We did this on the leg extension machine. We performed an MRI scan to look at thigh muscle volume, so again, before as well as after bed rest for both legs separately. We performed a CT as well as a DEXA scan, so the CT scan to look at thigh muscle cross-sectional area before and after bed rest for both legs, as well as a DEXA scan to look at lean body mass. We also provided our participants one day before as well as during the bed rest with deuterated water. And so this, together with the collection of taking muscle biopsies from both legs before and after bed rest, as well as the frequent collection of saliva and blood samples, this allowed us to calculate and assess muscle protein synthesis rates for both legs during the 14 days of bed rest. Now, just to give you a better idea of our study, I have some pictures as well. So here you can see one of our participants on the bed. He just was provided the food by us. And you can see he's sitting in an upright position. So because our study was more representative of a hospital rather than a spaceflight setting. So during the day, they were allowed to sit in this position when they were eating, when they were watching television or reading a book, for example. Of course, when they were going to sleep, they were in a supine position. Now, the blood flow restriction setup was as follows. So as I mentioned, we did place a cuff around both legs, but only one leg got the restriction, so the blood flow restriction every day. The leg press extension, the leg extension measurement, so to assess 1 RM strength, so for both legs separately before and after bed rest. Here you can see one of our participants in the MRI scan, so again to assess thigh muscle volume before and after bed rest. The CT scan to look into muscle cross-sectional area for both legs before and after bed rest. Here you can see one of the participants on the DEXA scan to assess lean body mass. And again, as I mentioned, with the ingestion of the deuterated water and the subsequent incorporation of tracer into the muscle by taking muscle biopsies again from both legs before and after bed rest, as well as the collection of blood samples, we were allowed or we were able to assess and calculate muscle protein synthesis rate during the period of bed rest for both legs. So what did we find in our study? If we first look into our DEXA scan results, then we saw that clearly bed rest strongly reduces lean body mass. And this was 1.8 kilograms in our study. And this is perfectly in line with previous literature. Now, when looking more specifically at the muscle data on the MRI scan, so when looking at muscle volume, we again found that bed rest strongly reduces muscle volume of about 5% in this case. However, there was no difference between the blood flow restricted when compared to the control leg. When looking at the CT scan data, again, we found that bed rest strongly reduces muscle thigh cross-sectional area. This was again 5%, but there was no difference between the blood flow restricted or the control leg. Now we're looking into strength. We again saw that there were clear reductions in muscle strength. So after the period of bed rest, so this was for both legs. And again, this was about 10% and there was no difference between the blood flow restricted or the control leg. Now we're looking at muscle protein synthesis rate. So what we found was that there was a muscle protein synthesis rate of about 1.1% per day. We know based on previous literature that this is indeed lower when compared to when you are, for example, in a more habitually active state. So then you see typically, at least we previously showed that you see that normally about 1.6% per day. So it is lower. However, there was no difference between the blood flow restricted when compared to the control leg. So basically, what we can conclude then based on our findings is that bed rest strongly reduces muscle mass as well as strength, which we know also from previous literature. However, blood flow restriction does not attenuate the reduction in muscle protein synthesis rates and also does not attenuate the loss in muscle mass as well as strength during a period of bed rest. And therefore, collectively, as a take-home message, we can say that blood flow restriction does not represent an effective strategy to attenuate the loss in muscle mass and also strength during a period of bed rest. So with this, I would like to thank my colleagues from the M3 Research Unit and everyone that was involved in this study, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I just have a quick methodological question. And is it exactly how did you come up with the decision of doing these 3x5-minute cycles? I mean, was there a rationale behind that, or your results would be different with different type of restrictions?
So what did you say as the last point? Sorry.
Yeah, if you think you would have different results from or different restrictions or timing, I don't know.
Okay. Yeah. So the restriction was based basically on previous literature. So we applied the 200 millimeter mercury pressure that has also been applied previously in immobilization studies, also more acute studies. We also took during the day roughly the same. So we took 9 sessions of blood flow restriction. Previous literature in immobilization used 10 sessions, so that's slightly different. But on the other hand, also previous immobilization study, for example, used 50 millimeter mercury as the pressure, which is substantially lower than we had. And they already saw some effects on muscle strength. So I think our protocol that we applied should have been strong enough to see effects on either muscle strength or muscle mass if there was any in a bed rest situation.
Thank you. Jose or Paul, if you have questions.
If I may, I just have a follow-up question in regards to your intervention, let's say blood flow restriction. Do you have a prediction of what is the average blood flow during the day between the two conditions, and what you call blood flow restriction during your 5 minutes? That's obviously blood flow will be lower there when you apply a 200 millimeter mercury pressure. But what will happen right after when you release the cuff? I mean, and the question is average blood flow over the day any different between the two conditions?
So that's a good question. We unfortunately couldn't measure that in this study. But what you would see after you would release the cuff, you see a reperfusion. So if you look in previous literature, you see briefly that the reperfusion is increased. So blood flow would be increased after you release the cuff. And this would be up there for like not that long, actually. Also in line with that question, because this was actually one of the things we were expecting, if there would be effects, maybe it's because of you see an increased blood flow after you release the cuff pressure. But based on previous literature, that does not really seem to be show any anabolic effects if you have the reperfusion. So that's what you basically see, but it doesn't really seem to be effective to attenuate or to increase muscle protein synthesis.
So the other question is, normally fractional amino acid uptake, it is extremely low. It is less than 1% or so. So do you think that changes in blood flow really drastically alter amino acid delivery to muscle?
I would think so, because we did a study previously, for example, where we applied cold water immersion, which we also know that you strongly reduce the blood flow towards the muscle. And there we saw that you really lower the amount of amino acids that you get from a protein drink into the muscle. So with the technique that we apply in our lab, we have the intrinsically labeled milk protein, so we can see exactly how much of the amino acids that are labeled are actually ending up in the muscle. And if you need to cool a leg, so you reduce the blood flow, you do see that less of these amino acids are ending up in the muscle. So potentially blood flow could definitely have an effect on anabolism.
With cooling, you're also changing the temperature of the muscle.
That's correct, yeah.
And the intracellular signaling controlling metabolism. So it's not a clean blood flow intervention. Thank you for your answer.
So if there's time, I'd just like to think about your thought process towards the mechanism. So if we look at the published literature where muscle protein synthesis is measured, we know that it's likely that muscle protein synthesis declines during exercise, during contraction, and that's been linked to a change in the cellular ATP-ADP ratio, which presumably ischemia would also do. We also know that hypoxia suppresses muscle protein synthesis, which you would imagine there would be something akin to that with occlusion. So what do you think the mechanism would be whereby occlusion would increase muscle protein synthesis over non-occlusion?
So yeah, what I based on this study and also a recent study that we published where we would only apply occlusion to the leg, we in both studies we did not see an increase in muscle protein synthesis. So exactly what you mentioned before with the mechanisms, I don't know if or how blood flow restriction on its own could be leading to an increase in muscle protein synthesis. What I do think, if you look into the literature of blood flow restriction with exercise, then you will recruit more motor neurons, so you will get faster to fatigue if you combine the blood flow restriction with low load exercise. I think that's the mechanism why you see an increase in muscle protein synthesis rate in that situation, based on our studies that I just mentioned. So this one, and as well as a previously published acute study where we do not see any effect on an increase in muscle protein synthesis, I don't really think that blood flow restriction on its own is able to, at least in a human setting, to increase muscle protein synthesis.
Sure. I'm just trying to get at the mechanism whereby you thought it would.
So
that's why you did the study.
No, exactly. So based on a previous study in rats, it was shown that if you apply only blood flow restriction, you see an increase in anabolic signaling markers. It was not really clear based on that study what could cause this. We also don't really know based on the previous literature. But we wanted to investigate, is it indeed that you see an increase in anabolic signaling if you apply blood flow restriction and thereby you increase muscle protein synthesis? And thereby eventually attenuate the loss in muscle mass and strength. I would agree that you see with, for example, with hypoxia, you don't really see an increase in muscle protein synthesis. So to me, it was also not really clear, but based on like quite some studies that have shown with immobilization that you attenuate the loss in muscle mass and strength, and also the suggestion that maybe it's because of muscle protein synthesis rates, we wanted to investigate that in our study. But again, we didn't see it. So I don't think blood flow restriction on its own could have any anabolic effect.
Okay, I need to stop you here. Thank you very much, Kaz, for your presentation. And being the last speaker, I thank everybody for this excellent session. So, of course, all the speakers for their excellent presentations, my co-chairs, and thank you everybody to who was connected listening to this excellent session. So. I wish everybody an excellent rest of the day and enjoy the rest of the conference.